Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Congregational Church of Laconia United Church of Christ, where no matter where you are on life's journey, you are always welcome here. It's good to see all of you with us this morning. This is the first time, as you can see, that we will be offering communion in the traditional way, or the way we had done it before COVID. For those of you who would prefer to use one of the little individual self-contained units, there are a few back there. Just let an usher know that you would like to use one. If not, we've taken some extra precautions in terms of placement of the bread on the trays and the cups in the trays and all of that, so that we know that it was prepared by the deacons using gloves and things like that. So we're taking every precaution we can. As you know, the transmission rate here in New Hampshire is in the red again, and so you'll see me wearing a mask all the time because, you know, I'm with this person and that person throughout the week and here in the morning, so I'm doing that to keep all of you safe, and we encourage you to use all the caution you can. But anyway, again, welcome to all of you worshiping with us at home, and we're glad that you joined us. I see there are like at least 15 or plus units or devices logged on this morning, so we welcome each and every one of you wherever you may be. Some of the announcements are we're going to have a video in just a moment, but some of them are here in the bulletin. You'll see them on the screen beforehand. One of the things I do want to do this morning is to thank Lorraine, who is back in the choir now, I think. There she is back there. Lorraine has been helping us out the past few weeks to give Bob some relief on the organ bench. But we give thanks to God because Bob is scheduled for his surgery tomorrow morning, bright and early. So we're praying that that will go well, yes. And we're grateful for that. But not anywhere near as grateful as Bob is to get this taken care of. So we keep Bob in our prayers during this time. Those are the announcements. Others you have seen. I don't think there are any others that I should highlight, although the video will be about the Strengthening the Church offering, which traditionally receive on today, Pentecost Day. You can tell by the balloons that this is Pentecost season of the Holy Spirit, the day of the Holy Spirit. So, and red is the color. Next Sunday, we should mention this. Next Sunday will be Horton Center Sunday, and we'll have Tivi and Tim will be with us from the Horton Center. And so all of you, any of you that have been to the Horton Center, or campers there, counselors there, deans there, we invite you to that next Sunday and to wear any Horton Center gear that you might have to celebrate that. Tim will be sharing the message with us, and we look forward to having him here with us. We have I'm not sure what the last count is, but we have a number of folks from our church going to the Horton Center for different camps this summer, so a great number. So, having seen no other announcements or any hands going up, this is a video this morning is on the Strengthening the Church offering. Again, we'll be taking it today and also any Sunday throughout the month. If you'd like to, you can make your check out to the church, just put in the memo line, Strengthening the Church offering. Mike? Give the Strengthening the Church offering, one of the four traditional offerings we take throughout the year and part of the United Church of Christ. And it's usually taken on Pentecost. This is, as you see, the offering that goes out to support the local churches throughout our country in the work that local churches are doing in many different ways. So we encourage you to give to that as a part of our covenant relationship with the wider church. Now here in our sanctuary, let us begin our worship together by lighting of the Christ candle, a time when we call to remember and to reflect upon the one into whom we gather for worship. We gather under the light of Christ, within the light of Christ, surrounded by the light of Christ, the light of Christ that is here through the Holy Spirit that indwells each and every person as we worship together. Let us worship in that spirit and in that light.
Please join me in the call to worship by reading the bold print. All together in one place.
They heard the rush of wild wind.
It filled the entire house.
Divided tongues as a fire.
On each of them.
They were filled with the Holy Spirit.
And day by day.
First hymn this morning you'll find in your, it's an insert in your bulletin, and we invite you to stand as we sing together, All Are Welcome.
Thank you.
Call to confession. God's Spirit has gathered us for worship. Let us confess those sins which hinder our relationship with God. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Spirit of God, we build walls and barriers. We assume and stereotype. We devalue difference and stick with what is known and familiar. Forgive our lack of courage. Embolden us to cross boundaries of difference. Fill us with your Holy Spirit that gathers us and calls us to community. Amen.
As we read in the gospel, in the book of Acts, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. For it is in Jesus Christ that we are forgiven and freed. Amen.
I will go, Lord.
The scripture reading today is from the book of John, chapter 20, verse 19 through 23. Later on that day, the disciples had gathered together, but fearful of the Jews, had locked all the doors in the house. Jesus entered, stood among them, and said, "Peace to you." Then he showed them his hands and sighed. The disciples, seeing the master with his own eyes, are exuberant. Jesus repeated his greeting, "Peace to you. Just as the Father sent me, I send you." Then he took a deep breath and breathed into them. "Receive the Holy Spirit," he said. "If you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them?" May God bless this reading.
A couple of things I failed to mention during announcements is the flowers that are on the altar. The wonderful bouquet of the arrangement of flowers on the left is given shared with us by our church's Open and Affirming Committee in honor of Pride Month, which is June, and with their prayer that all will enjoy the freedoms and the fullness of life that is deserved just as being part of the human species, the human race, if you will. The other roses on the altar are in honor of John Gauthier's birthday, which I believe is this coming, it's coming this week. I'm not sure of the date. But John, no? I see. Oh, towards the end of the month. It's in June. Okay, not this week. But anyway, John is turning 102. So if you remember, a couple of years ago, we celebrated, he was here, and we sang happy birthday to him, and I believe we did it with the Air Force hymn or something like that, as I recall, because John is an Air Force veteran. But if you see John or you want to send him a note, 102 this coming month. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Holy God, as we reflect upon this passage that Margie read for us today and the words that speak to us through Scripture, I pray that you open hearts and minds. I pray that you have worked within me that the words that I share might reveal a little bit more, help people understand a little bit more, take a little bit different approach to it, to see things anew, that your name might be glorified and not mine, for I am only here as a speaker of your words, as an amplifier of your voice. Amen. Well, today, as you know, with the red balloons, the red stole, red, it's Pentecost Sunday. As most pastors will tell you, their red stoles are the brightest and cleanest of all their stoles because we only wear them one day, one Sunday out of the year. Most Christian churches will read on this Sunday and probably focus on the passage from the second chapter of Acts, a very familiar story of Pentecost where the Holy Spirit comes down upon the believers gathered in that room like a wind, and it appears as if a flame of fire hovers over the edge of all those who were gathered there. And then those around them out in the streets hear and understand each other. They understand what the disciples are saying because the disciples are speaking in their own tongue, their own languages. And then Peter proclaims in sermon, if you will, that this is what the prophet Joel was speaking of, that God is indeed pouring out the Spirit on all people. Yet also, in the readings for this day, is this reading that Margie read from the Gospel of John, chapter 20. Here we have, if you will, another Pentecost story, and one I believe that's worth exploring. Now, it's important from the onset to establish the fact that the account of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2 and the one in John 20 verses 19 through 23 do not necessarily contradict one another. Now, I had someone call me once many years ago, said, "Pastor, what's this? Which is the true Pentecost? When Jesus breathes on them in John or in Acts? That happens weeks, months, maybe later." Well, I think it's important to realize that they don't necessarily contradict one another. We do not have to choose one account over the other. Choose one as better than the other or downgrade one of them. The Acts passage is the more familiar passage to us as the appearance of the Holy Spirit, sometimes wrongly referred to as the coming of the Holy Spirit, as if the Spirit or the Spirit had never been experienced before. You know, people like some people like to think, well, the Holy Spirit is something of the New Testament. No, it's there in the Old Testament as well. You know, John's passage is just as important for reasons as the Acts passage, and like those for us to consider that. Speaking of the Spirit showing up in the Old Testament, of the First Testament, the Spirit of God appears in the Bible in a variety of ways. Indeed, in the very opening scenes of the Bible, in the book of Genesis, we read where the Spirit of God hovered over the waters, over the face of the deep, and brought forth life. And in today's reading, Jesus breathes the Spirit on a company of disciples and energizes them for ministry. The story in John's Gospel takes place on Easter evening. The disciples, we do not know how many, are in a locked room. They were hiding. They were afraid. Seemingly out of nowhere, Jesus appears in their midst. How? We don't know. It doesn't tell us. It's not important. Jesus says, "Peace be with you," which may have a powerful and spiritual connotation. However, it could be a simple greeting. You know, peace be with you. I'd rather imagine Jesus saying something like this. He all of a sudden he appears in their midst and he says, "Hey there, it's me. You know, you can try to lock me out, but I'm coming anyway. Your fear will not keep me away." Powerful words from the risen Christ to a group huddling in fear, unsure of what to do or where to go next. Now, for all intents and purposes, Christ seems to ignore that fear. He doesn't even knock. He just shows up, walks right in. Christ tends to do the same thing with us. Despite our fears, our misgivings, our doubts, he comes bursting into our lives over and over again as if to say, "I'm here, whatever you want. Whether you want to acknowledge me or not, here I am." Now, I heard of a wall plaque that reads, "Good morning, this is God. I will be handling all your problems today. I will not need your help, so have a good day. I love you." Well, Christ's message is a little like this. He's saying, "I'm here, and I'm not going away." However, unlike that wall plaque, Jesus does seem to need, they're the ones who are to carry on the work that he began. And what kind of work is that? Well, there are many, many examples of throughout the Gospels of Jesus's ministry, encompassing a wide variety of works. I mean, he went healing, and there's the teaching to advising, even moments when he acts out in frustration and anger. Yet here, in John's Gospel, the risen Christ coming back to those disciples, we see Jesus emphasizing one thing, the work of forgiveness. This seems to be key to the rest of the Gospel message. You know, in a world where people are kept down by sin, or at least are being told they are sinful, the message of Christ is indeed life-giving, a breath of fresh air. Now, without asking a show of hands, how many of you have ever felt guilty? You don't have to put your hands up. How many of you have been made to feel guilty? Yeah. How many of you have felt shame because of something you said or did? No, yeah. How many of you have ever felt shame or guilt because of something said to you? Yeah. Guilt and shame are deadly realities in our world. They can affect how we live, how we respond to others, and how we share our gifts. They can control our lives if we're not careful. They can make us continue to do things we wished we didn't, which in turn adds to the guilt and shame, and it becomes a vicious cycle. At their worst, they can lead us to suicide. Is it any wonder then that Jesus says to his disciples that as God has sent him, so I send you. Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Jesus sends them on a mission of forgiveness. It's in the Message translation of the Bible that Eugene Peterson renders the second half of verse 23 this way. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them? What are you going to do with them? The thought here is that any withheld forgiveness really ends up holding back the withholder more than the one to be forgiven. Think about it. The one holding or withholding forgiveness often bottles all that up inside and ends up suffering the most. Another new translation called The Voice puts this verse this way. As you go, you are able to share life-giving power to forgive sins or to withhold forgiveness. This version suggests not so much that we really have a choice, but rather that we have the power to do amazing life-giving work. And if we don't, again, who will? Someone else? We can never be sure. Still another version, a paraphrase, is called Good as New, a radical retelling of the scriptures. States puts this verse this way. From now on, your job is to free people from their guilt. Otherwise, they will remain prisoners of their past mistakes. Wow. Powerful. Powerful that we have that ability to give that life-giving spirit. When I think about it, in the Gospel of John, of all the things that Jesus did and all the things that he taught and all the ways he interacted with people, of all the things Jesus could emphasize upon his return, he chooses forgiveness. He challenges the disciples then and us today to share the message that transforms the most of all, that we do not need to be kept down by guilt or shame. As I set people free, Jesus says, so I am sending you. Now go and do the same. This is the most important of all the ministries you could perform. Without knowing that we are forgiven, we can become paralyzed. Life can become a tightly knit affair of not knowing if we can ever raise our heads, ever become a full person, ever know the freedom and joy God intended for us from the very beginning. But Jesus changes all of that. Jesus repeatedly sets us free and challenges us in turn to share this good news and to do the same for others. In the words of the first verse of our opening hymn, let us build a house where love can dwell and all safely live. A place where saints and children tell how hearts learn to forgive. Built of hopes and dreams and visions, rock of faith and vault of grace, here the love of Christ shall end divisions. All are welcome. All are welcome. All are welcome in this place. May it be so. Amen. As we prepare for a time of prayer and sharing our concerns, there are those that people have passed in through the either to Donna or through the online folks. And Karen asked for prayers for Bob, hopes that his surgery goes well and he feels better and pain goes away. Bob Phillips is asking for prayers for his brother John and neighbor Ken Brock. And Ted Tunnicliffe is asking for prayers for his friend Maggie, who has difficulty with chemo at John Hopkins. And Donna and I ask for prayers for Otto Lowe, our son-in-law's father, who has health issues and needs to be seen by a specialist. He's out in Indiana. Are there other concerns that you'd like to mention? We're not going to be passing the microphone, but as I hear you, I will try to repeat the gist of it. If you have any particular concerns that you would like to share this morning, Dave? Thank you. I know if you did everybody hear that? He's a joy for the flags that were out for the over the Memorial Day holiday week. Anything else? Prayer concerns, joys, praises? Mark. Good, good. Mark is just giving thanks that his mom, who usually struggles with dementia, was able to get out and have a good day outdoors. Steve. Okay. Steve lifts up a prayer of gratitude for the ambulance folks who came and helped lift his mother, who fell and broke her hip, but she's had having surgery.
Mother-in-law,
and is having surgery to repair that broken hip. Anything else? Yes, Jerry. What was his first name, Jerry?
Ed.
So prayers for Jerry's brother-in-law, Ed, who is dying of cancer. Anything else? Well, then I invite you who are gathered with us here and all of you who join in us from home. Let us be in the spirit of prayer for all of these folks, the ones that have been shared through the online, those shared here in person. Let us be in that spirit of prayer. Gracious God, you are the God of love and freedom. You are forever calling us into new and exciting relationships with you and with one another. You seek to break down those walls that we too often set up that keep us from one another and from you. You offer us forgiveness and challenge us to forgive others. Oh, but Lord, it isn't always easy. For some do not want or feel the need for forgiveness. And some I would rather not even think about forgiving. But we believe your word, and so we pray that you'd help us when we struggle against our own humanity. Help us to have faith that when we are not sure what the future might hold for us, you will boldly fill us to overflowing with your Holy Spirit, as you have with so many others in the past and still do today. As you sent out the first disciples by breathing on them the Spirit, Breathe on us and equip us with every good thing to do your will as you send us out to serve the world you created and love. And hear our prayers for those who are sick, for those who are injured, for those who are recovering from illness and injury, but especially on this day, hear our prayers for those who are struggling with the burden of guilt and shame. Free them in the forgiveness that you offer to all. And if there is an occasion where we might be the conduit for that for forgiveness, use us. This morning, hear our prayers for those who are serving our community's common good, whether it is in government or our schools, in our local law enforcement, fire and emergency medical personnel, our armed forces. We pray for their safety and give you thanks for all that they provide for the good of our community. We pray for those who are serving in the mission and outreach ministries and non-religious that reach beyond our reach, touch those that we cannot touch, help those too many believe are beyond touch. And we pray for those who are in authority over us, that you would grant them a fuller understanding of their responsibility, a responsibility for the common good, for all people, and not just the few. Help us, O God, through this journey we call life, and sojourn with us even now, and make us your Easter people forever. For we pray in the name of the one who comes into our lives unexpectedly and says, "Peace be with you." Amen. As we enter into the time of Holy Communion, we invite you to stand as we sing together verse 1 of "Spirit of God, Descend Upon My Heart." You may be seated. Luke the evangelist wrote of our risen Savior, who at table with two of the disciples took bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. Their eyes were opened and they recognized the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread. In company with all believers in every time and beyond time, we come to this table to know the risen Christ in the breaking of the bread. And here at the Congregational Church of Laconia United Church of Christ, as we say, no matter where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. You are welcome at this table. We do not segregate or separate out people by religious affiliation. People of faith, people of no faith, people struggling with their faith, you're all welcome to share at this table. Let us pray. Eternal God, who has created the heavens and the earth, giving breath to every living thing, we thank you for all the gifts of creation and for the gift of life itself. We thank you for making us in your own image, for forgiving us when we act as though you have no claim on us, and for keeping us in your steadfast care. We rejoice in Jesus Christ, the only one eternally begotten by you, who was born of your servant Mary, who shared the joys and sorrows of life as we know it. So we remember Christ's death, and we celebrate Christ's resurrection. And in the beloved community of your church, we await Christ's return at the end of history. We take courage from the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit in our midst. We offer you our praise for women and men of faith in every age who stand as witnesses to your love and justice. With all the prophets, martyrs, and saints, and all the company of heaven, we glorify you. And as we come to this table, O God, we remember a table of memory. We remember on that night of betrayal and desertion how Jesus took that bread and broke it after giving thanks to you and gave it to his disciples, said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And we also remember how in the same way Jesus took the cup after supper, saying, "Drink this cup. It is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." By eating this bread and drinking this cup, we proclaim Christ's death, celebrate Christ's resurrection, and await Christ's coming again. Let us now join our voices together in praying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Gracious God, we would ask that you would bless this bread and cup and all of us with the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Through this meal, make us the body of Christ, the church, your servant people, that we may be salt and light and leaven for the furtherance of your will in the world. Amen. Again, we remember how Jesus took and he broke the bread. He said, "Take and share with all the people. Let us share this meal together as we remember the body of Christ." the body of Christ broken for you. Eat, remembering him. Amen. And as Jesus took the cup, he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do so, remembering me." We now share the cup of the new covenant. The cup of the new covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do so remembering him. Amen. Join with me in the praying of our prayer of thanksgiving. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table, granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is "Spirit, Spirit of Gentleness." Invite you to stand as you're able as we sing our closing hymn.
Spirit, Spirit of gentleness flow through the wilderness, calling and free.
Now may the Holy Spirit kindle flames of love in our hearts. May it transform all that is fearful into boldness of heart. Inspire us with wonder and awe at the mystery of God's presence. Confirm us in compassion and forgiveness. May the Spirit whisper discernment in the midst of confusion, wisdom in times of trouble, reverence in the face of diversity, patience with the unfolding of life, and forever anoint you with joy. Amen.